Morning, everybody. You guys are too kind. I love you guys too. Well, hey, if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Ephesians chapter 3. That's where we're going to be today. Ephesians chapter 3. And hey, if we have not met, if this is your first time, my name is John. I have the wonderful privilege of being the campus pastor here at this campus. We are so glad that you joined us here for church today. If this is your first time back in a while, we want to welcome you back to church as well. We're just so glad that everybody made it to church today on this beautiful weather. I don't know about you guys, but does anybody have like allergies? Okay, if you don't have pollen, it's don't worry, it's all in my eyes. Okay, that's where it's at. Okay, if you don't have allergies, you're welcome. All right, but hey, I'm excited. We're back in our series in Ephesians. We've been looking at it verse by verse, chapter by chapter. I don't know about you, but I've been learning a lot. I've been learning a lot from Dr. Radalnik. The Lord is growing me and continually to remind me and teaching me of his ways. And you guys have enjoyed our series in Ephesians. Yeah, it's been incredible. So before we dig in, I just thought it'd be helpful for us to do just a little bit of recap, okay? So we have the chart up here, okay? So as we've been walking through Ephesians, we're still in the believer's wealth section, okay? The sit part, okay? It's been a lot of who we are and who and what God has done for us. That's where we've been. We've been in the believer's wealth that God has given all of us. If we are in Christ, in him has been a phrase that we've seen over and over again in our series, that we have a tremendous wealth and that we are tremendously rich in Christ. That's where we've been the whole time. It's been full of imperatives. There hasn't been a ton of commands. There hasn't been any like, we should do this, okay? That's coming in chapter 4 and 6, but so far, it's been a lot of indicatives, okay? And last week, we looked at the second half of Ephesians chapter 2, where Paul writes that all division can be overcome and resolved by the gospel, because Jesus, says in verse 14, has torn down the walls of hostility. Jesus has accomplished that. So there doesn't have to be any division. There doesn't have to be any strife between different ethnicities because we are one in Christ. God has reconciled people to himself from every nation, every tongue, every tribe. Therefore, we can be reconciled together. It doesn't matter our differences because the gospel, it breaks it down. It tears down that wall. It's a beautiful message. And if you haven't got to listen to that message by Dr. Radalnik, I strongly encourage you to, because it's a fantastic message, all right? And so today, we are in Ephesians chapter 3. I don't know if you looked ahead just now or you read ahead, but we're talking about a mystery. We're talking about a secret that was hidden all throughout the Old Testament and was never even mentioned, okay? It wasn't mentioned until Jesus told the Apostle Paul. This mystery, this hidden secret. Okay? Kind of sounds intriguing, right? Kind of sounds important, right? Well, it totally is, okay? Because it's a secret. It's a mystery that God revealed to the Apostle Paul. Now, if we were all honest in here, we all love to be in on a good secret, right? We all like to be in the know. We like to know that thing, that secret, that few people have any knowledge about. Whether it's like a surprise for someone, like a surprise birthday party, a 40th birthday party, or 60, whatever it is, or you know the gender of a baby, of a family member before a lot of people know. Or you might know that he bought the ring and he's about to propose, but like only like a few people know. Like we like to be in the know. We like to know those things, okay? The mystery, the secret that we're talking about this morning is a little bit different. And here's how. Nobody knew. There wasn't even a hint. There wasn't even like any sort of knowledge about it. God had it to himself. Jesus never even alludes or hints to this secret, this mystery we're talking about this morning. So it was super on the DL, right? No one knew about it, okay? Until it was revealed to the Apostle Paul, all right? So this is what biblically, I have it on the screen, this is biblically what a mystery is. This is what we're talking about this morning, okay? Biblically, a mystery is something that humankind would not and could not know unless God reveals it himself. All right? Let me say it one more time. Mystery in the Bible is something that humankind could not and would not know unless God himself revealed it to someone. All right? It's not like someone has a secret And you got to like pry it out of them, where you got to like, come on, tell me, or beg them, okay? And then they finally tell you. Not like that. It's like nobody knew. Like no one had even a clue that it was a thing, okay? So that's what we're going to look at this morning. So this morning, this is the main point, okay? This is the nail. This is the theme, okay? We're going to look at how this mystery was made known or revealed so that the gospel could be made known to all. Okay, that's the main driving point. We're going to look at how the mystery was revealed and then really how it impacts us today. Okay, before we start, let me pray that we're going to dive right into God's word. Let me pray. Father God, I pray right now, Holy Spirit, that you would illuminate your word. God, your word is truth. It's ultimate truth. This is our guide. This is your disclosure of how we know you. So God, I pray this morning that what we learn and what we hear about this incredible mystery would cause us to worship you more and more, that we would rest in your salvation plan that you disclosed to Paul, that now that we all know. And God, I'm just honest. I don't care what people think about my preaching. All I care about is that your word goes forth and it accomplishes the purposes that you have for it. So God, would you just use me as your servant? Would you just use me this morning? I want to be helpful to our church family that I love so much. In Christ's name we pray, amen. We're going to be looking at the first 13 verses of chapter 3. And before we get in, just real quick, this is Paul's explanation of the mystery that was revealed to him, okay? That's what we're looking at. It's actually one long run-on sentence, okay? Paul does this a lot, okay? Paul just gets really excited and he starts writing, like the theology head he is, okay? And he just forgets what he learned in grammar school, okay? It's okay. It's okay because Paul gets excited, okay? Paul had every intention to pray, okay, to pray. That's why it says in verse 1, for this reason. And then if you look at chapter 3, verse 14, it says, for this reason. He was going to pray, okay? And you'll see the dash in verse 1 of chapter 3 at the end of the verse. He had every reason to pray, but the Spirit, it just like stops him. Stops and says, hey, Paul, before you go into your prayer, before you thank God, before you worship God of this mystery and that the Gentiles and Jews can be one, you need to explain a little bit more about this mystery, okay? Which makes sense because it's a mystery, all right? So let's look at chapter 3, verse 1. It says this, for this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, on behalf of you Gentiles. All right, we're going to pause right here and kind of unpack this. Paul says that he's in prison. He's in jail, okay? And he says that he's a prisoner of Christ, which is interesting. He doesn't say he's a prisoner of Rome. He says he's a prisoner of who? Christ. Gives you that perspective, right? That he saw his relationship with Christ in everything he was and did, and even in his circumstances. That's an incredible perspective. He says that he's in prison on behalf of the Gentiles, okay? So if you remember way back when we started our look at the book of Ephesians, Paul's in prison because of an accusation, okay? He's in prison. So you can read this account in Acts chapter 21 and 22. So Paul's preaching the gospel to the Ephesians, to the Gentiles, okay? And you have to understand, as we said this last week, but Jews and Gentiles, there was a lot of hostility. That's why Paul writes the book of Ephesians, to say Christ has broken that down. There's a lot of hostility. So the Jews, they had a wall that separated them from Gentiles. Gentiles meaning everybody that's not of Jewish descent, okay? And so there was an assumption, an accusation, that Paul had brought Gentiles into the temple court, which is a big no-no to the Jews, okay? Notice it was an accusation. They assumed, okay? So they heard, you know how rumors get started, right? You hear something. They heard that, oh, Paul's brought this Gentile into our temple courts, and they're having bacon, okay? Something like that, right? Like, they're eating pork sandwiches, right? So this accusation. So here's what the Jews do. They seize him. They go in. They grab Paul. They drag him out of the city, and they sought to kill him. So it just, there's so much disorder with the Jews. There's so much chaos that the Romans, Gentiles, had to step in and rescue Paul. And it was crazy. It's so crazy. It says in Acts 21 and 22, they literally had to pick Paul and carry him above their heads to get him out. That's how much the Jews hated Paul. They wanted to kill him. So they're carrying him out, and Paul says, hey, can I say something? Can I just speak to the people, the Jews? Can I speak? And they say, yes, because he speaks. And there's 21 verses of Paul just telling his testimony. Here's who I was. Here's my calling, 21 verses. And then at the end of his message, when he's speaking, he says, Jesus called me to be a light to the Gentiles. This sets the Jews off. And here's what they say. Here's what they say. They say, away with such a fellow from this earth. He should not be allowed to live. And the crowd went crazy again. Okay? Why did this tick off the Jews? Why did this tick off the Jews? Because they don't like Gentiles. They don't know this mystery, and they certainly don't believe in it yet. That's why. So this is the reason why Paul's in prison. He's been on prison, so the Romans arrest him, and he's been caught. Like, I don't know if you guys have any idea how long Paul was in prison, but when he writes the letter to the Ephesians, he's been in prison for a while, like years. Not like a day or two, and then he's like, oh, I'm gonna write the Bible, okay? No, he's been in there for years. He's caught in the Roman governmental system, okay? So that's why he's writing. Look down at verse 2. It says this, assuming that you have heard of the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for you, how the mystery, there's our word, was made known to me by revelation, or made known, as I have written briefly. When you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ. Okay, so this is important. This was when the mystery was revealed to Paul. When was the mystery revealed to Paul? When he was converted. Okay, so if you know Paul's former life, Paul was honestly a self-righteous, Gentile-hating Jew that killed and imprisoned and murdered Christians. That was his former life. You can read this in Philippians 3. Paul was everything right of what a Jew wanted to be. Everything, like perfect, okay? He hated Gentiles because, again, most Jews in this time thought, Gentiles aren't us. They're unclean, they're not believers. They don't have the promises of the Messiah, the covenants. They don't do our traditions. They're not part of our culture. This was Paul in every way, for sure. This is when, so Paul, we first see his former name was, you guys know his former name? Saul. Saul, he approves the first Christian martyr, which was Stephen in Acts 7. And then in Acts 8, literally the next verse, it says, Paul began to hurl threats and ravage and persecute the church. That's what his job was. And he took a lot of pleasure in it, right? Against believers and Christians. So on his way to continue to hurl threats and murder and imprison Christians, what happens? Jesus, a light shines in on him, knocks him on the ground. And Jesus appears and says, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And Saul's converted to Christianity right there. And also, don't miss this. This is important in our text this morning. That's when he receives his calling to be a light to the Gentiles. This would have been an amazing insight to him because, again, his background, he hated Gentiles. He imprisoned Christians. Jesus says, not anymore. 180, you're going to be a light to the Gentiles. So Paul is fulfilling his calling. So that's what he means when he says, assuming you have heard of the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me. The stewardship and the grace that Paul was given was to be a light to the Gentiles. That's what his calling, okay? So what I want to do is stop right here and just ask this question. Ask this question. What are you doing, Christian, believer in Christ, with what God has given you to steward and manage? What are you doing? How are you stewarding? How are you doing with what God's given you? How are you doing? What grace has God given you? Are you using your gifts? What opportunities has God laid before you that you perceive that you could take advantage of for kingdom advancement? Or maybe how are you contributing to the church? How are you loving God's church? It's not my church. How are you contributing to the bride of Christ that Jesus died for and paid his life for? I want to say this, that church is not just to fill our heads with biblical knowledge. That's not just why we're here. You want to know what we're after? Transformation. That's what we're about. We're about transformation into the likeness of Jesus Christ. We're not just here to fill our heads and just receive all this. No, that's not what we're here for. We're here to serve Jesus, to serve one another, and be a light in our community. Here's a phrase that we came up with this week. What we learn about who God is and what he's done for us through Jesus leads to how we live. It's true. What we learn about God, who God is, and what he's done for us through Jesus leads and informs to how we live. So you see Jesus loving people. We love people. You see Jesus serving. By the way, Jesus is serving us right now. We are to serve. How are you using your time, your gifts, your opportunities, your talents for the Lord? What grace, measure of grace, and opportunities has God given you? Our second point this morning about the mystery, if you're taking notes, write this down, is Christ unites with the mystery, many will become family. Christ unites with the mystery, many will become family. What an amazing truth. Look at verse 6. This mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Okay, if you have a Bible or you're taking notes, circle verse 6. That's the mystery. Or write mystery next to verse 6. That's the mystery that was revealed to Paul. What's the mystery? It's that Jews and Gentiles, meaning every other person in the world that's not a Jew, are equally part of the church and equally share in the blessings, the spiritual blessings in Christ. That's the mystery that was revealed to Paul. This is the mystery that was hidden for ages. Now to us, it's like we probably get that because we know that we're one body, one church, but you have to understand, no one knew this then. No Jew understood this. No Gentile knew. No Gentile knew. This right here, this mystery, when Paul said this to a Jewish hearer, it would have made their mouth drop, make their jaw drop. They wouldn't have believed this, okay? Some Jews might have withdrawn their membership from the temple. I would perceive that, okay? They might have, right? Because the Jews' understanding of the Gentiles were that they would be saved, that they'd be saved through the Messiah. But the Jews never dreamed, never would have imagined, never would have even guessed that the Gentiles would have equal share in the blessings of Christ and be one in the church. They had no idea that was coming. And that's the mystery. That's the mystery that was revealed. I mean, look back in verse 6. You could see just the language of Paul. He says that the Gentiles are members of the same body, fellow heirs, partakers of the promises in Christ Jesus. It's language of inclusion, of oneness, of unity, because Christ unites with the mystery. And Paul says in Galatians 3:28 later, he says that there's neither Jew nor Gentile. There's neither slave nor free, male or female, but all are one in Jesus Christ, purchased by the blood of Christ. And that's why you don't see like just an American church or just a Jewish church or an African-American church or an Asian church, okay? We're all one body. We're all brothers and sisters. We're all united in this wonderful mystery that was revealed to Paul. And listen, that's mysterious. That's mysterious. That God would take different people with different ethnicities and different backgrounds and bring them together as one. There's nothing like it in the world where this exists. Not even anything close. Because literally, you could go to California, you can go to Jamaica, you can go to Europe, you can go down the street, literally, you could throw a rock and hit a church from our church, right? Where there's a lot of churches around here. And you can instantly become one with them. Why? Because all that matters is the blood of Christ. All that matters is Jesus Christ. Jesus unites with the mystery, and it's beautiful. It's beautiful, it's incredible. I mean, I just look in this room, so many different backgrounds, so many different ethnicities. What brought us here together? Jesus.
And we can do a lot together. The mystery that Christ reveals unites us. It unites us. When we lived in Kentucky, we were able to go on a lot of mission trips. We were just a sending church. And I was able to go to Poland. I was able to go to Haiti a number of times, Guatemala, a lot of different places, a lot of places that weren't in the United States, okay? And here's what I learned and perceived really fast. There's a lot of differences. There's a lot of differences in these different cultures, different places, okay? Different languages, different ethnicities, different rhythms of life. Here in America, especially Chicagoland, we're so fast-paced, okay? In a lot of Spanish-speaking places, it's like they don't have a watch, okay? It's like, we'll do it when we get to it. We'll wake up, and like me being a little type A, it's like, we got to get that 8, we got to do this. I've made a list a week ago, it's like, but they're just like, whatever. I'm like, okay, God, patience, A lot of differences. A lot of differences, okay? But listen, when we came together to worship or serve together, none of those differences matter. Why? Because of Jesus. There was always this song that we would sing. It felt like in every different place that we went on a mission trip. The song at that time was Mighty Safe. You guys remember Mighty Safe? Yeah, it was like the song, like I think like 10 or 15 years ago. Maybe longer than that, I don't know. But we'd always sing that song, okay? And so in these different places, they'd be singing it in Spanish. We'd be singing it in English, in Polish or Czech or whatever the language was. And it was really cool. It was really cool. It's one of the best worship experiences I've ever had. I knew what they were saying behind the song because I knew the song. It was almost like it was a glimpse of heaven, that there was so many different languages, different people represented. And we were all just singing who Jesus is and why we love him and why we trust him and why we worship him. And that's amazing. And that's the mystery. That's the mystery. Jesus unites us all. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. All that matters is that you love Jesus and I love Jesus. So three truths about this that I want to bring to your attention. First is this. This truth should awaken us to worship God. Like, that's the first thing. It should awaken us to worship God. Okay? We should praise God that the mystery includes us. Okay? That the mystery includes us. Check this out. Like I said, I'm guessing that 95%, maybe not of all of us in here, are Gentiles. We're Gentiles. We're not of Jewish descent. God's plan from the beginning was that Gentiles would be included and share in the same blessings and be one church with his chosen people, the Jews, and that the mystery would be revealed to Paul. We're sitting here this morning. I just want to point out the obvious. We're sitting here this morning because Paul stewarded his grace, that he was a light to the Gentiles. And thousands of years later, when Paul started his ministry, the gospel has been passed down to all of us, all the thousands of years, and now we're here today. We should thank God that we're included in this, that we're included in his plan. This should just well up in us thankfulness, gratitude. Thank you, Jesus, for including us. Thank you that you don't discriminate, but thank you, God, that you save equally to everybody. Jesus, I like to say this, is an equal opportunist savior. Doesn't matter your background. Doesn't matter what you look like. Let that God of work testimony. It doesn't matter your past. All that matters is, have you repented and trust in Jesus Christ? And you're in. You're in. Worship God for that. Second truth, that this truth should unite us together. It should unite us together. Write this down. Unity matters to God. Unity matters to God. How much? Well, Jesus prayed for it hours before he was crucified on the cross. In John 17, Jesus prays in the garden. He prays for future believers that they would be, do you guys know? One. We would be one. That we would put our differences and our preferences aside and focus on what really matters, the gospel, Jesus Christ. Jesus prayed for that. And we must be diligent to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. Because here's the facts. There's enough division in our world. There's a lot of division in our world. I don't know if you watch the news or on Facebook. It's just everybody's divided on a lot of things, a lot of unimportant things. Sometimes it's good just not to get on social media or watch the news. I'm just gonna be honest, right? Like, sometimes you need a break from it. There's a lot of division in our world. There's division in our workplaces. There's division in our schools. And sometimes there's division in our churches. And that grieves the heart of God. It grieves the heart of God. Why does it grieve the heart of God when his people are divided? Because Jesus paid for our unity. He paid for his church to be one. And we have to strive, church family, to be one. It takes hard work. It takes prayer. It takes conversations. All right? So how do we maintain unity? How do we maintain the bond of peace that Paul talks about? How do we maintain being one? Well, one answer, there's many, Paul writes about in 1 Corinthians 14. And it's simply this: by being involved and serving one another. That's it. By serving one another and loving each other. By being one and involved. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 14:26, the body of Christ is built up in oneness when we're all, guess what the word all in Greek means? All. When we're all contributing the gifts that God's given you, the spiritual gifts, the steward, they're not for you. They're for us. Here's how I like to say it. We need you. We need you. We need everybody. And guess what? You need us. That's how God designed this thing to work, this church. That's how we can maintain unity within us, with all the believers worldwide, church, Big C, is by being involved in serving one another. So let me ask you this question. How are you contributing? How are you involved? How are you serving the bride of Christ that Jesus paid his life for, in unity that matters to God? How are you maintaining that unity? Only you can answer that question. And I just want to say we have plenty of opportunities for you to do that here at our church. And it would be our greatest joy to help you find your place to serve or a small group of ministry to be in. We love to do that. Even if you're not sure, we'll try to help you, all right? We're one church. We're one body with one faith, one Lord, and one mission, all right? I'm just reminded of this. It's been 3 weeks now. We served the Aurora Christian Healthcare, all right? We have a photo of some of us that were out there. And there was around 35 or 40 of us on a Saturday morning moving the healthcare from one church to downtown Aurora. And you know what? It wasn't just Harvest Aurora people there. There were different people from different churches, different backgrounds, different ethnicities, wide spectrum of ages, different jobs. But it didn't matter. We were there for one purpose: to serve Aurora Christian Healthcare. And it was awesome. Just a picture of unity. So let's be that church. Let's be one. Let's seek opportunities. Let's steward whatever God's grace that he's given to us for the glory and the fame of Jesus Christ. Third truth. This truth revealed to Paul can save you today. It can save you today. I don't know if you've come in here and you haven't trusted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Maybe you're a student. Maybe you're an adult. I don't know who you are. Maybe you haven't fully trusted Jesus Christ. Well, I have good news for you. You can today. I'm not trying to push it. I'm just saying you can. Because the gospel includes everybody. It doesn't matter your age. It doesn't matter your background. Okay? It doesn't matter your ethnicity. The blood of Christ can cover anybody. It doesn't matter your past. I mean, look at Paul. My goodness. My goodness. He could save you. God could save you. So is today your day that you want to be all in with Jesus? Today would be a great day to be all in with Jesus. He's ready to receive you. This mystery could save you. All right, finally this morning, our last point. Number three, Christ provides purpose through the mystery. What the church does matters for eternity. Christ provides purpose through the mystery. What the church does matters for eternity. Look at verse 7. Paul says this, of this gospel, which I was made a minister. Minister actually doesn't mean like what I am, like a minister. Okay, it means in Greek, a servant. So he's calling himself a servant. I was made a servant according to the gift of grace, which was given to me by the working power. To me, though I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. What is Paul saying here? Okay, Paul is recalling his former life. We're seeing the humility in Paul. He says that he's a servant of this grace, of this gospel that he was given. He says that I am, though, the very least of all these saints. Paul's looking back, like how we can kind of look back to our former life in Christ. It should humble us that Jesus knew all our sins, knew all that we would do, but yet, as we looked in Ephesians 1, he chose us before the foundations of the world to be in him. Does that just like blow your mind? That God saw all the sin that we would commit, and yet he saves us. Like, what? That's so backwards to how we are, right? But God's different, and praise God that he's different, right? Paul's looking back. He's basically saying, oh my goodness, I totally didn't deserve to be, one, saved, and two, to be handed this gospel and this ministry to be a light to the Gentiles. That's what he's saying. And he's humbled by it. He's humbled by it. And here's what I don't want to miss this morning. And this girl on the God of Work, I just keep going back to her this morning. She almost said it. God uses imperfect people. God uses people with a story. God uses people like Paul, like me, like you, to spread, as Paul says, the unsearchable riches in Christ. Like Christ, he's saying that he's a treasure, that when people discover, it's incredible. They're all in because it's that amazing. And the Bible is filled with people that are imperfect. And hopefully no one's come here thinking like, I'm an elite Christian. I've had a good life. Well, compared to Jesus, you haven't, all right? That's all of us, all right? That's all of us, all right? Maybe with your neighbor or with someone at work, you're a little bit better person. But compared to Jesus, not so much, all right? Not so much. And that's what Paul's saying, okay? Paul's saying that, all right? The Bible, it's filled with imperfect people that God uses for his glory. Abraham, Moses, he murders a person, and God uses him to lead the people out of Egypt. All right? David commits adultery with a woman and then has her husband on purpose killed on the front lines. But yet, David's called a man after God's own heart. How? Peter. We don't have time to go through Peter's life, but he messes up a lot. He's known most for denying Christ 3 times, right before Jesus is crucified. But God uses him. Jesus used him, and Peter's one of the greatest preachers and leaders. It even dies a martyr's death for Jesus. If God can use those people, he can use you. He can use me. And it's humbling that God would use us to tell about what he's done for everybody, that everybody can be included in the church and share in the blessings of Christ and have an inheritance that we've been talking about this whole series. It includes everybody. So here's what I encourage you to do. Witness. Witness. Share what God has done in your life. A lot of people, and maybe this is you, if this is you, it's okay. I just want to encourage you. That's all I'm trying to do. Sometimes I hear this a lot. I don't know the gospel, Pastor John. I don't know what I would say. And I get, like when you're witnessing or talking to someone, there's a little bit of like, what am I going to say? What if they ask me some questions I don't know? Okay, first off, it's okay to say you don't know the answer to the question. That's humility. Say, hey, maybe let's try to discover this together. But listen, the gospel. The gospel is this: when you witness, just share what God has done in your life. Here's who I was, and here's what God has done for me through Christ, and here's where I am today. And although I'm not a finished product, God's not done with me, I'm sure not who I was. Can I tell you more? That's all it is. You don't have to be like this pastor, this theological, like, here's the gospel. You don't have to do that. If that's kind of who you are, that's okay. But, like, be yourself. Just share what God's done in your life. and then let God do the rest. We can't change people's hearts. Salvation belongs to Jesus. And God can take anybody out of the grave and make them alive. We don't know who, but we herald and preach the gospel to everybody because we never know. All right? Look at verse 11 and 12. All scripture is beautiful, but this is what, I love this verse. 11 says, "This was according to the eternal purpose that was realized in Christ Jesus our Lord." Verse 12, "In whom we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in him." If you are in Christ, if you know Jesus, guess what? You have total access to him. You can approach God the Father in boldness, knowing that there's going to be grace there. That you're going to find grace. That's just so incredible. Prayer, access to God, it's a gift. Like, Jesus, he not only does he save us from our sins and forgive us, he wants to have communion with us. Like, he wants us. I'm just going to be honest real quick. I'm so excited that Pastor Jeff is coming to be our lead teaching pastor. I'm so excited. Like, personally, with other campus pastors in an interview, we got to spend some time with him. And I can't tell you, in those meetings, and then on the video we showed last week, I just sense and see the excitement in him that he wants to be here at Harvest, that he wants to come here. Like, he wants to come be our pastor and help us and teach God's word to us. It's nice to be wanted, you know? It's nice for someone to want to come. It's amazing that God the Father wants us. He wants to hear from us. And Paul's saying this mystery that's been revealed, part of this mystery is not only are we saved, not only are we one and sharing the blessings of Christ, but that we have access to God. And we can approach him in boldness. And we can commune with him. What a gift. What a gift. The last verse this morning of Paul's digression. Verse 13. "So I ask you not to lose heart over what I am suffering for you, which is your glory." Wow. What is Paul doing here? He's shepherding. He's pastoring his people. You see, these Gentiles, Paul's been in prison like we looked at. He's been in prison for years. And these people that love Paul came to Ephesus to plant a church, and then he's gone. He's away. They're worried about him. How is Paul going to preach the gospel? How is Paul going to be a light to the Gentiles if he's in prison? And Paul says, hey, listen, I'm okay. I'm okay. Don't lose heart. I'm where I'm supposed to be. My imprisonment, it has a purpose. It's purposeful. This is for you. Don't be discouraged. The reason why I'm in prison is because I love you, and I love Jesus, and I want you to know that it's going to be fine and it's worth it. Now, that's a friend. That's a friend. It sounds kind of close to what Jesus says in John 15:13. That greater love has no man than this, than a friend that would be willing to lay his life down for another. This is putting on the mind of Christ. Paul goes through everything, even prison, so that the Gentiles and the Jews could be one, for this mystery to be revealed, and so everybody can have a chance to come to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior. So, as we close this morning, Michael Rodownik's been doing these, what's the takeaway? Here's the takeaway. Go and share. That's it. Go and share. The mystery has been revealed to us. We know the mystery thousands of years later, that everybody's included, that the gospel has no boundaries. It doesn't discriminate. It has no distinction, but everybody can come straight to the cross. This was good news for the Gentiles because they thought, man, we got to adopt this Jewish culture and traditions. No, straight to the cross, straight to Jesus. So this morning, the application is for us to go and share this good news with everybody. Share what Christ has done in our hearts. To share what gets us up in the morning sometimes when it's hard. To share what excites us, what energizes us. We do this all the time in our lives. We share things that we love and excite us. Like if something happens in our lives, we want to tell someone, a phone call, a text message, or a Zoom call, I don't know, that's where we are. We're on social media, like when I scroll through social media, I see people share life updates that they're really excited about. Hey, we're moving, we're going here, someone got baptized, or that a prayer was answered, a new career, a wedding anniversary, birthdays, photos of your grandchildren that you're like super proud of, or your kids' achievements in sports or school or whatever it is. I think back to when Melissa and I first started dating. Not super early, because you don't want to be like super early when you're dating someone. You don't want to be like, you know, that person. When we started to date, I was like, this is awesome. She wants to be with me, right? I know it's confusing when you look at it. You're like, how? I don't know. By God's power, okay? It happened, and we're locked in, okay? But listen, I wanted to tell my family, I want to tell my friends, hey, there's this beautiful woman that loves the Lord that wants to be with me. And I wanted to share. Shouldn't this be the heart of us with this mystery and with the gospel news? It should be more than way more than that. To share the love of Christ. To share the good news of what God has done in our lives. So here's what I want you to do. Think of one person right now. Just think of one person. Who's that one person that God's bringing to mind right now? Or maybe it's just easier, just like, yeah, it's my neighbor. Or yeah, it's my family members or my classmate sitting right next to me. Who's that one person? What I want us to do, go ahead, bow your heads and close your eyes. Do you have that one person? I do. Right now, just pray. Whoever that person is, God, would you open up their heart right now? Would you use me to plant seeds? Would you use me? Would you give me a door or an opportunity to be able to share what you've done in my life with this person? Jesus, would you reveal yourself through me? Use me as the vehicle to proclaim the unsearchable riches of your Son, Jesus Christ. And God, the reason why we're praying that this morning is because only you can change hearts. Jesus, only you can give the amount of grace and mercy and kindness and love. So God, may we just be a church, a campus that's discontent with where we are in our walk with you, and so people can know all around us who you are. Ignite that fire in us, God, to be your vessels, your ambassadors for people that don't know you. God, just open our eyes to the opportunities you have before us. To serve as a church, to steward the grace given to whatever that is that you've given us. God, we want to do this well. We want to do this well. We love you so much.